For a long time, I've been wanting to do some content talking about storage, as I've played with that over the last 6 years or so. And while there is already a lot of good content out there, I find, personally, that it either keeps it a little bit too basic, or it goes over the top with virtualizing an entire rack or something. But what if I'm just looking for content about this one thing, but in detail? Well, there's always Wendell. In any case, I've been wanting to talk about my server, a Supermicro 846 chassis with 24 drives running TrueNAS Core. I call it Big Iron. It has decent sequential performance of about 1 GB per second right now, read and write. When it was new and empty, probably more like 1.5-ish. And thankfully, nearly my entire workload is sequential. I just need to pause right here while I am editing the video. I haven't really benchmarked my server in years, because back then I didn't really understand how FIO worked. Now I do after some reading. And so I wanted to verify my claim about the 1 GB per second read and write. Turns out, it's a lot better. Write speeds directly to the pool is about 1.5 to 2 gigabytes per second. This is purely sequential, a single thread or single transfer, and one QD. So Q depth of one. So quite a bit more than I initially expected, especially since my pool is 80% full or thereabouts, but even more so held back by Gigabit. But all that performance is stuck in that 4U chassis because I've only ever known Gigabit networking. Until today, because on God, for real, I'm hurting, and I'm going to be upgrading to 10 Gigabit networking between my main desktop and my server. And by today, I mean weeks ago. Although I initially considered faster options like 25 Gigabit, that requires running my own fiber, and it isn't super feasible with where I am living right now. Perhaps in the future, I'll explore 100 Gigabit when I have my own house. Look at the chapters if you want to skip to testing or some sort of specific information. It's worth mentioning that my server consumes a lot of power, as you might expect, for what essentially serves as an archive box. I'm not actually working off of it in real time. As a result, it's not always powered on, and I only fire it up for specific things like moving finished projects over to it, which might be multiple terabytes in size. And with 1 Gigabit, that does take quite a while. With faster networking, I can minimize the server's uptime and reduce wasted electricity. I kind of treat it like a really big and resilient external hard drive. You can see when I'm copying data as fast as I can over Gigabit, the data fills up the normal RAM cache of about 5 seconds, then it's flushed to the pool. Look up ZFS transaction groups for how that works. It's not really a RAM cache, but it's easier to explain. It's more like grouping writes together. Point is that on Gigabit, the server is quite literally waiting on data, though even a single modern hard drive is almost twice as fast as Gigabit. In order to move to 10 Gigabit, here's what I'm working with. SFP Plus didn't quite make sense for me in this case, so I decided on native RJ45. The TP-Link TX401 10 Gigabit NIC. It's PCI Express 3x4, which I imagine makes this compatible with a few different configurations. Maybe you're on only Gen 2, maybe you only have two 3.0 lanes. Both of those should be plenty. It's based on the Marvell AQtion chipset, and I've seen reports of it working well in Proxmox. I'll be finding out for sure. As for switches, I have the TRENDnet TEG-S750, which is a 5-port 10 gigabit switch, unmanaged and fanless. This will sit on my desk, connect to an existing 8-port gigabit switch, and connect my PC, consoles, and other accessories together. I also have the TRENDnet TEG-S762, which will be tucked away in the so-called network closet. It'll connect my office, server, and main network together for internet. In terms of cabling, there is existing Cat 6 in the walls that I'll be using. The electrician should reconsider their career choice based on what we got when we moved in. Look at this trash. I did fix it up myself with the punch downs and the crimps, and they seem to be working fine. While it is just Cat6 and not Cat6a, it should still handle 10 gigabit since it's likely under 30 meters, as per spec. Without further ado, time to get started and install the 10 gigabit NIC. Now, I hear you asking, wow, why am I watching this? I don't know, really. But your other question might be why I only bought one NIC. Well, because my desktop's ASUS ProArt X670E has one built in, with a very similar or maybe even identical chip by Marvell. Not sure. I also had to make some short Cat6 cables to connect the switches. Here's a rough drawing of my current network layout. The cost of this upgrade was around $570, not including cables and crimping tools I already have. It was well worth it. Configuring the server with the new NIC was easy. When booting up the server, I left the existing network connection where it was, so I could connect to the Proxmox dashboard and configure the networking. I added the new NIC to the virtualized Linux bridge, applied the configuration, and refreshed. Then I removed the old NIC from the bridge to reduce overhead. Hopefully, maybe. Time for the results. Using iPerf, I achieved about 9.5 gigabits per second on a single transfer to the Proxmox host, which is running an old pair of E5 2650 V2s based on Ivy Bridge. I think this immediately shows the switches and cabling is working well. When testing iPerf to the TrueNAS Core VM, I observed around 7.5 gigabits per second, suggesting some performance loss due to virtualizing the switch. Maybe? However, running a second stream immediately reached 9.5 gigabits per second, possibly due to multithreading or a deeper queue. I'm using a GUI called JPerf, by the way. I'll link it below. In terms of real-world file transfers over standard SMB shares, the speeds do vary. I have reached speeds of 850 megabytes per second at times, depending on which VDEVs are active in ZFS. Though I've noticed more typically, speeds will range from 350 to 500 megabytes per second. Running multiple transfers together, I can utilize more of my pool's potential, reaching around 750 to 800 megabytes per second. CrystalDiskMark provides some variety in the data. With one thread, it reaches around 550 megabytes per second read and write. Moving to two threads, it achieves that iPerf potential of around 800 megabytes per second. Based on my monitoring, writes hit the pool at about 1 gigabyte per second, occasionally, while reads likely come straight from the read cache, or ARC. The switches themselves don't have much to show, but they're doing their job just fine. The S762, the 10 gigabit plus 2.5 gigabit switch, is quietly working in the network closet, connecting my server and PC to the internet. The 5-port TEG S750 sits on my desk, linking my PC to the network and connecting other accessories like consoles and smaller PCs via another gigabit switch. I stacked it on top for better airflow for right now, even though it looks a little bit silly. But both remained barely warm to the touch, even when transferring data at full speed for hours. And I of course love that both are fanless. Reliability-wise, despite using Cat6 cable and not Cat6a, and terminating things myself, everything's been functioning well. I experienced some dropouts, possibly due to the Marvell controller, which apparently sucks on these motherboards. However, turning off energy-efficient Ethernet in the advanced NIC settings seems to have helped, and I haven't encountered any problems ever since. Overall, I would say I'm thrilled with the massive increase in usable speed to and from my server. It also opens up possibilities for future higher performance compact servers that I've been wanting to work on. Like I mentioned before, this server in the video mainly serves as an archive, so I turn it on once a month, maybe, to update files or transfer a large chunk of data. However, my next project involves an all SSD server for editing purposes, where SATA drives will probably suffice, especially only on 10 gigabit. Stay subscribed for future updates. I'm also going to be talking about the Google Workspace situation and how it ties into this 10 gigabit upgrade. But that is all for now. Talk to you later.